ish. I had to clean your apartment too because I had stuff everywhere.
I want to jump in real quick and say that we are live on Alpha Geek Radio and on YouTube. We're not starting the show yet, but we are live. This is kind of our pre-show. It's awesome that you were able to join us tonight, Bonnie.
Can you hear me okay? Yes, is the audio all right?
Yeah, no, sounds great.
Okay.
I want to introduce you to our co-hosts. That's JF Dubow from Montreal, Canada. And then the two people in the same shot, that is Brad and Anessa. They are coming to you from Wausau, Wisconsin.
Wow.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
And I'm in Ottawa, Ontario, Canada.
Okay. And I'm from San Francisco.
we're covering the coasts, practically.
And in the continent.
And I kind of live by three bus stops, so if you hear screaming, that's pedestrians that are trying to chase the I live by three buses and a train, so...
Oh, boy.
They're around the time they're screaming because our public transportation system in San Francisco is mean and angry, and they like to make people run for the bus. Apologize if you're hearing screaming. It's not an alien attack. It's just... angry commuter.
You know what? It would be cool if it was an alien attack. I would welcome that more.
I would never know the difference because the screams are pretty much the same. There are either horrified screams or angry screams, and then there's gibberish. So it really could be an alien invasion. I would never know. So, but hey, at least if it's an alien invasion, you'll get to record it.
Yeah, exactly. We can witness it.
Yeah.
It can be our person on the street for that.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, so any questions, any of you guys about the rundown, anything that we're going to talk about tonight, any questions, concerns, comments?
How do you want me to interact? Because this feels like this is you guys' show, and then do you just want me to interject, or do you want me to, how is this usually?
You're not a guest. You are a guest, yes, but you're also... definitely part of the show, so you can jump in anytime you want, Bonnie.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Feel free to throw a verbal elbow and get on in there.
All right.
Yeah, just step on our toes. You can insult us. We don't care.
And how long
Wait, whoa. Speak for yourself, Dave.
How long is the show usually?
I have a fragile ego. I'd like to preserve it.
I promise not to hurt you.
It goes about an hour, Bonnie.
Okay.
Well, no, I didn't say that either.
Do you have a hard out? Do you need to be out at a certain time?
No, I have a bunch of... I write for... I'm behind on my deadlines, so... Because I was sick this week, so my editors are emailing me from CNET, Playboy, and SFX going, hey, you have stuff due. Where are you? Are you dead? So I just... I need to get that stuff done. As much as I would love to just talk with you guys for 8 hours, I probably should get work done, too, so...
You know, not many of our guests throw those type of names around. You know, CNET, Playboy, SFXmagazine. No. It's just a thing.
This is what happens when you've been a freelance journalist for most of your career, and then you all of a sudden have to depend on freelance money. Because it used to be I would work at an entertainment company, or a computer company. I was at Lucasfilm for 10 years, and then... Before that, I was at Nullsoft, which produced Winamp. And before that, I was in the first dot-com boom, so it would be At Home Network, which turned into Excite at Home. And before that, I was at Apple. So I was always had a real job that was at a desk. And so once after Discovery Channel did a reorg, because I went there after Lucasfilm, I was like, I kind of want to work from home. I'm too old to go into an office and deal with office politics. So I kind of want to... So now I just work from home in my pajamas, and my supervisor's my dog. So,
see, there you go.
Works out. That's the and then I do stuff like this, and I don't have to worry about chasing after a bus to get home.
Where they just scream at you anyway.
The bus system here in San Francisco, it's like the opening of Law and Order. You never really know what you're going to get. Sometimes you're the victim, sometimes you're the bystander, sometimes you just get to watch people beat the crap out of each other at the back of the bus. So it's, you know, So fun. I'm not on a
dull bus. Never a dull day.
Never dull.
Yeah.
This is gold. This is great material. Let's start the show so it can be actually part of the show. So. All right. Let me start the intro. I got a new spanky new?
Excuse
no.
Me?
Brand spanking new intro. Them? So
is that kind of podcast?
could you guys do me a favor and mute your microphones for like 30 seconds? You all know how to do that? This is the first time that we've done this, Bonnie, so. It doesn't really matter. I'll just crank it up. Here we go. 3, 2, 1.
This is Alpha Geek Radio. Visit tunein.alphageekradio.com to learn more.
The following is a presentation of GalacticNetcasts.com.
Attention, Galactic Collective. The Sci-Fi Geeks Club is next. Please stand by.
You can take part in the podcast by providing feedback. Send a message to galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. Call the voicemail number at 805-328-3966 or leave an audio message directly on our website, galacticnetcasts.com. We also invite you to join the Galactic Collective. All the information and links can be found at gncasts.com/Galactic Collective. That's gncasts.com/Galactic Collective.
All right, welcome to the Sci-Fi Geeks Club.
Now, without further ado... Hear ye! Another meeting of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club is officially called to order!
I'm Dave Nelson. Joining me on the host panel this time around is Brad Ludwig, Anessa Moyens, J.F. Dubow, and our guest this week is the author of Star Wars craft book Girls Against Girls and More. She writes at CNET. Crave, Playboy, SFXmagazine, Disney, and more. She's also part of the Vaginal Fantasy Book Club, which I feel dirty saying.
I don't think that's how you pronounce it, but it sounded good.
Wait a second.
Vaginal Fantasy.
Not Vagi.
Oh my God, Dave, you're finally becoming Canadian. You're becoming one of us.
I think
welcome.
So. Canadian.
I think so. Go ahead.
Sorry. I didn't mean to embarrass you. I used to call it vaginal, and then Felicia Day, who's our co-host on the show, said that is not how you pronounce it. It's vag, like vaginal. And I'm like, oh. But when you say vaginal, an ointment, and when you say vaginal, it sounds like a cool party.
Either way.
There might be a dose of regional pronunciation in there, too.
After viewers, I'm really sorry.
Oh, no worries.
Okay, welcome to the Sci-Fi Geeks Club, Bonnie Burton. Bonnie, how are you?
I'm good. I showered for this because I realized I was going to be on camera at the last minute, and I sort of cleaned my apartment so it doesn't look too bad. So, yay! Thanks.
Wait a second. Do you see my background? I'm in a basement. So,
look at you guys. We all have professional microphones, which I do have. I just don't know where I put mine, and I don't have headphones on, so sorry.
Well, that's quite all right.
I can see you. This is my tech right here.
Boom. Done.
Good enough.
I, however, did not shower for this, but unfortunately it's not smell-o-vision, so everybody should be okay.
And I may or may not be wearing pants. You don't know.
Even that. Me neither.
So, Bonnie, tell us about your projects. I mean, I rattled off a whole bunch of things, but tell us about the most interesting aspects of what you... Because you freelance. You do all kinds of different things. So tell us kind of a snippet of your life.
Okay. Well, when you're freelance, you tend to live a lonely life where your only interaction is with the UPS and Amazon delivery guys, your corner bodega, the pizza delivery guy, and your dog. That's pretty much my social life right now. That sounds like a cry for help, but it's not. I've always worked in offices. I worked at Lucasfilm for 10 years, and then I went on to Revision 3, which was a part of Discovery Channel for about a year. And then when they did layoffs, I was like, you know what? I kind of just want to work from home. I'm old enough to have responsibility, I think, and I can do this. So I've always freelanced on the side just to, as a journalist, that's always good to do so you don't, like, lose your writing chops. And now I just do it completely freelance. So I write mostly for CNET.com. So I try to do about 15 articles a week for them, which is quite a bit, but it's still really fun, geeky pop culture stuff. A lot of Star Wars reporting, Marvel reporting, but I also do weird robots, bizarre Kickstarters, things like that. And then I just started writing again for Playboy. I took a little bit of a break because I was trying to get a book done, because I also write books on the side. So I'm starting up for Playboy again, and then I write a monthly column for SFXmagazine, which is a British entertainment magazine that I've had for about 4 years now. I do a geeky, kind of like a geeky girl perspective, and I have a column due for them like 2 days ago, so I have to like get that done. I'm writing about PK Dick's predictions of the future on how they actually came true, and he just made all that stuff up, and they came true, but Asimov, who was like a hard sci-fi writer, tried to predict the future and used real science and was totally off base. So I'm basically saying if you're paranoid, you'll probably be a better fortune teller. So I'm writing that. I do a lot of stuff, and I'm writing two books right now that I can't talk about because I haven't been allowed to announce them yet, but they're like crafty, fun books. So there are going to be two more artsy, weird craft stuff. But doing a craft book is a lot different than writing fiction. Fiction, you can have your house sort of in order, and you can write. Craft book, it looks like a Michaels or a Hobby Lobby terrorist blew up in your like, I just, in the middle of the night, I stepped on a pile of glitter, and I didn't know I had stepped on it until I woke up this morning, and it looked like Studio 54 and I had an interaction.
You're saying that like it's a bad thing.
It's like a bed rave. Yeah, but once you have glitter and your glitter's like the herpes of the craft world. Once you have it, you have glitter. So there's like glitter in my carpet from like three books ago. My dog still has glitter on her, and she's been cleaned multiple times. So I just glitter's forever. Just remember that if you have a craft,
just accept your destiny as a fairy queen.
Yeah, it's literally forever. I think I still have glitter from the 80s on me at some point. So I don't know. It's forever. But that's snapshot of my life is, it sounds fun, but it could be a little grueling. And my hours are crazy, so I usually write best from 11 p.m. till 5 in the morning, and then I go to sleep at around 6 in the morning, and I wake up around noon. So, yeah. So it's impossible to, like, I'm always up super late, but I'm never up super early. Well, I guess I am technically, but then I usually go to bed, so... That, I feel like I'm at an AA meeting or something. I'm sorry.
No, not at all.
No, not at all.
But that's if you. Yeah, nice. Everybody drinking? Are you allowed to say?
Can I say what I'm drinking, Dave?
Yeah, I mean, we have a feature on this podcast about drinks, so go ahead.
Oh, true. I have a pre-prepared gag for that one. I'm having a 12-year-old Colilla. It's a delicious scotch that's a bit extremely peaty, but still rather smooth.
I'm glad you said scotch because it sounded like you said 12-year-old cola, and I was like, did they last that long?
No, it's the brand of scotch. The label is Colilla.
Oh, okay, cool.
Are you drinking, Bonnie?
You're gonna be horrified at what I'm drinking. It's not alcohol, and it's kind of cloudy. I'm almost done with it. It's I can't even pronounce it. It's something earth. It's dirt. I'm drinking dirt. It's like this clay that you're supposed to drink to cleanse yourself. Have you heard of this?
No. It's like, no, and I don't want to hear any more.
Yeah, it feels like, you know when you like work in the garage or in the garden or something, and then you take your first swig of water, and it tastes like dirt because you're covered in dirt because you were cleaning or gardening or whatever? That's what this tastes like. So
you're clearly not part of their marketing team because you're not selling it.
Well, you're supposed to drink it. I was sick last week, and then you're supposed to drink it to kind of for a cleanse, to just get all that stuff out, but I'm suspicious that it was just some guy who's like, I got a lot of this clay. I wonder how I can sell it to idiot hippies. Oh, I know. I'll say it's a cleanse. So I'm starting to think I was suckered into this, but it was only like $4 for a giant bag, and if I don't want to drink it, I can always use it in my gardening, I guess. I don't know.
I was thinking the same thing, exactly.
Yeah. But I usually...
All right.
In the podcast, I usually drink alcohol. I usually drink a lot of alcohol, which is why I'm doing a cleanse right now, so... Sorry. You're going to get cleanse high instead of drunk me. Oh, well. What do you guys drink?
Water? I'm drinking iced tea. What? You guys are drinking water?
Yeah, well, I'm...
So I'm the only winner? Wino? Whatever?
Well, on occasion, we drink, but today I'm recovering from a migraine, and I don't think alcohol would be the way to go.
rum and cola.
I'm eating. I'm starting to feel bad now that I mentioned that.
No, don't.
Hey, Bonnie, this is Fly by the Seat of Her Pants, okay. Whatever Happened podcast, yeah, no so worries. Don't worry about it. It's okay.
We're all real people. We're all real people here. We're all adults. Everything's fine. Well, we're mostly adults.
We're adults. Can you say everything's fine? Are you trying to quote solo?
As I'm trying to say this while I have a stack of Funko Pop figures sitting off to the side.
Yeah, those are great. Is one of those... I'm trying to figure out the red one. I can't figure it out.
This is Vision. The Vision.
Oh, okay.
And then we've got Oliver Queen. And then the X-Files figures. So we have the alien from Jose Chung from Outer Space, Cigarette Smoking Man, and then Scully and Mulder.
Are the X-Files ones new or are those old?
No, those are new.
They're new, yep.
Oh, well, I think I should write about those for CNET then.
Boom, yeah, done. Look at that. Your work's half done for your CNET article.
Thank you. You're welcome. All right, let's jump into the actual news of the week. Yeah. These are the top sci-fi headlines. What's that, Bonnie?
I said, yeah, let's do the real show instead of just me totally train wrecking it.
No, it's okay. So, it's totally
you're the guest, so I think you having my time is planned, but I could be wrong.
Okay.
I'm not a regular.
Yeah, you are. Jesus.
Are you one of the hosts?
I'm semi-regular. I'm kept on a short leash.
He's a fill-in host, but he's not enough to be for us to make fun of him like crazy. So.
Oh no, well, no, cut loose.
Oh,
cut
we loose. Do. Oh, we do.
Okay, okay. It's first story. Let's get serious real quick. Huge, huge sad news this week. Composer James Horner dies in a plane crash. 61 years old. He was piloting the plane. This happened around Santa Barbara, 60 miles north of Santa Barbara. A few of Horner's many compositions include Aliens, Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, Avatar, Krull, Star Trek III, The Search for Spock, Titanic, Patriot Games, Apollo 13, and Braveheart. And, only 61 years old. That's a bummer. That's a big-time bummer. He had a lot more. I mean, look at who's the Star Wars composer?
John Williams.
John Williams.
How old is Williams right now?
Just don't do that. Don't jinx it. Because the minute we start talking about how we're so glad he's alive, he dies.
Yeah.
I did that.
So we're really angry he's still alive. God damn it.
I
die already.
Why won't he die?
I did that with Christopher Lee, and I jinxed it. And
you're the one.
That again. So we're
he's
not
83.
Talking about Williams or George Lucas. Leave those guys alone for a while.
Okay. Do we have one nearby? Knock on it, please.
Sorry, what?
I mean, if you want to talk about how lucky we are that Michael Bay is still alive, go for it.
Oh, man, oh, that's awesome that he's still
that
alive.
That freaking guy.
He's going to live forever.
He doesn't have a freak accident soon.
Hey. Lay off Michael Bay. Who knows? He might be doing, like, The Rock 2 at some point. We never know when he'll do another good movie. Probably never, but...
Never.
He did a couple of good ones, right? I mean, they're all not. They're not all
weird.
Name one.
The Rock. The Rock's a good movie.
Okay.
Not a brilliant movie, but it's mildly entertaining compared to the other movies.
It's not based on anything.
Okay. How about a movie from the 2000s?
Yeah.
Well, no.
And also, okay, one that doesn't have Sean Connery in it.
See, that raises the bar. I mean, Sean Connery could be in Sharknado and make it a good movie.
Wait, was Sharknado
calm down.
Presidio or The Rock? I always get those confused.
He was in The Rock.
Okay, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah.
He's also
along with Nicolas Cage?
I don't know.
No, The Rock was Sean Connery and Nicolas Cage.
Yeah. Who was in Presidio? Who is the Presidio actor?
That other guy.
Costner and Meg Ryan. And Sean Connery. I only remember that because at Lucasfilm, we had moved from Skywalker to the Presidio. And so for a full week, everyone was doing their Sean Connery impressions of him saying the Presidio over and over and over. Because the Presidio used to be a military base. That's why that movie...
I stayed in the Presidio. I out-processed in the Presidio. So I know exactly. We might have been in this... I might have slept in the same building that you worked in, Bonnie. Who knows?
Well, you mean you slept there when it was a military base? Because that used to be a mental hospital, so I think we're revealing a lot right now.
This is getting creepier the more we talk about it, Dave. You might want to pull back from this.
Yeah, that's Presidio, where Lucasfilm is, used to be the old mental hospital. So that's why everyone thinks it's haunted. Okay. Because
also, saying I might have slept where you work is like the worst come-on ever.
That is vaguely creepy. Hey, baby, I might have slept where you worked.
I might still do.
I'm calling from inside the house.
Which kind of makes me think of an article I saw today about this family who purchased a house in New Jersey for like $1.3 million, and apparently it came with a stalker. They started getting like all these creepy letters, like, I am the watcher, and my father used to watch this back in the 1920s.
Oh my God.
You put like new blood in the house, and I'm watching, and have they discovered what's in the walls yet? Like, the family was like, screw this, we're out. Now they're suing
the... You have to send me that link. You have to tweet that link to me, because I want to read that article. I'm so obsessed right now with like haunted houses and stalkers and creepy things, so send it to me.
Oh, well, this is like the perfect article for you then.
Yeah. No, it's funny. When I was at Denver Comic Con, I met some actual paranormal journalists, and that's all they do is they write anything about paranormal they write about, and they're ghost hunters as well. So I might team up with them to do a new web series about ghost hunting, because I'm totally obsessed with that. And I think most of the ghost hunter shows that are out right now are too bro-y. You know, they're too, like, frat boy.
Bro hunter.
Like, you know what I'm talking about. Like, when you watch Ghost Hunters, they're like, it looks like drunk frat boys in an abandoned building yelling at things they can't see. That's basically what most of those...
So just drunk frat boys, then.
Yeah.
Which one is that? Is that Ghost Adventures, the one where he yells at the ghosts every time?
Bully them. He basically, like, I want to do another show, but from the ghost perspective, almost like a Beetlejuice kind of thing, where the ghosts are like, hey, this is where we live. Inside voice, man. Like, just, like, the ghosts are the victims of these drunk frat boys that barge into their homes and try to bully them into, like, pushing them down the stairs. Like, that's basically what Ghost Hunters is. So, I think that would be a great show, right? To do it from like the ghost perspective of we were just having our little ghost tea, watching some TV, and then all of a sudden these frat boys come in and like kick down our stairway. Like, I think it'd be great.
Yeah, and then have the ghost messing with them the whole time, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. Anyway, sorry. We were talking about what now?
Yeah. Speaking of ghosts, let's go back to James Horner.
Yeah, no, I think we're done. I mean, I think we can all agree that it's a big loss. 61 years old. He was a great composer. I mean, come on, Star Trek II: Wrath of Khan. That music is so recognizable. Brad and I were talking about that on our previous podcast. How you can hear like a note from the Star Trek II: Wrath of Khan soundtrack, and you know exactly what it is right away.
The thing that was kind of weird for me is that when I first saw the tweet storm about James Horner dying, I'm terrible with name. It's a good day when I remember my own. So I said, whatever. And then I saw the references to the movies, and they're all movies that I owned to start the soundtracks very young. Like the Battle of the Mutara Nebula, which is one of the key songs in Wrath of Khan.
Oh, yes.
The music in Wrath of Khan. I had that on a loop for so many years. And the music from Aliens is iconic. Avatar, maybe less so. And that's when it hit me, that's when I kind of got sad about it.
He's kind of like the guy, I mean, he's like John Williams in the sense that he's the composer that, you know, he basically has touched so many movies that we all love that when we hear a soundtrack, we know immediately what movie that's from. That's a sign of a really good composer. Yeah, and I mean, it's really now where I feel like most movies just use whatever hits are of the day. They don't even bother with soundtracks. I think it's good that people are reminding us all that we need movies that have original music in it, not just something from Smash Mouth. Like, I feel I feel like a lot of those movies are just, okay, well, we're just going to use whatever is popular. I remember there was a time in the late 90s, the same bands got picked for all movies. So it was Westward, Smash Mouth, Prodigy.
I'm guessing Blink-182 doing the soundtrack for Force Awakens isn't you're looking for.
It was like, it was like five or six bands that everyone was using that music for. And I was just like, well, why? What happened to the original, you know, soundtracks that are original music that are orchestra-based or just really unique? And, you know, I still listen to Blade Runner soundtrack by Vangelis. That's one of my favorites.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I have all the Star Wars soundtracks, obviously, because I worked at Lucasfilm, so it's kind of like a cult. If you don't listen to it, they beat you. But, no, I'm kidding. kidding. But, no, it's one of those things where after I found out he died, I looked up how many movies he's done music for, and it's just, it's astounding. It's astounding how much he was doing and how much he had touched our lives, and we didn't even really know his name, and it's kind of sad that he didn't have name recognition like John.
That's the thing that surprised me, is like, you think, like, James Horner, as much as he was influential and very prolific, like, insanely prolific, he didn't seem to have the same star power as Hans Zimmer, John Williams, and some of the other big-time classical composers. Like, he did his thing, and his thing was amazing, but he didn't seem to shine in the spotlight as much as his contemporaries.
And I don't know if that's because he just wasn't, like, awards hungry, or, I mean, it's not like those other composers are either, but maybe we're starting to pay attention more to composers because of the Hans Zimmer effect, in a way, or because John Williams is always on tour with his movie music, where he plays with
the orchestra. I think that has a lot to do with it, is he's putting himself out there, he's interacting more with the public, versus these other composers who don't really tour, like John Williams does. And so, you know, you're not going to remember or think of Howard Shore first. You're going to think of John Williams when you think of movie composers, and probably Hans Zimmer as well. I just think a lot of it has to do with the fact that they're more interactive with the public than maybe some of the other composers are or were. They might have changed over the years. I don't know. I haven't really paid that much attention.
It's interesting, too, to note that some directors are starting to use popular musicians who are now composing, like Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross.
Yep.
You know Trent from Nine Inch Nails, but when you look at the music he's been composing for Fincher's movies lately, I mean, I love the Social Network music soundtrack. That's one of my favorite soundtracks right now. But I think he did Dragon Girl with a Dragon Tattoo. Yep. They also did Gone Girl. I can't remember what they're working on, but it's interesting to see that transition too from people that you're used to seeing front and center with their bands. They're now more comfortable it's more enticing for them to do composing for movies because it's a different way to express themselves. I mean, there was a time too where the big joke was, you know, if Danny Elfman died, we'd never get another Tim Burton movie because Tim Burton was so heavily relying on Elfman's music. Right, for every single Tim Burton sound, or for every single Tim Burton movie. And then Mark Mothersby from Devo, you know, he was a big TV show composer. So it's just interesting to see that difference of, as far as famous composers, we either know them from bands, or we know them for always winning awards, there's a background of composers that are prolific that we don't even pay attention to.
And Danny Elfman was in, he was in a band too.
Boingo Boingo.
Boingo, yeah. So that tradition, you know, has been happening for a while now. Bands going and then becoming composers. That's interesting.
I know I'm going tangent a bit, but do you feel that we're seeing, probably because of the internet and the fact that there's so much more information, like if you back 5 years, you had maybe one or two names attached to movies as the draw, and no one cared that much about directors except maybe a handful of them. But now, I mean, now we're seeing music by Hans Zimmer being put forward. We're seeing directors. We're seeing writers. Like, it seems like the public cares a lot more about the ingredients that goes into making a motion picture, including the people who score the movies, than before. Or is it just something I'm feeling?
You know, I think it's the internet effect. I think people are more informed than they used to be.
Yeah.
You can get a lot more details about movies and their productions than you could, you know, 10, 15 years ago.
Yeah, and we learn about movies so much earlier than before the release than we used to now. So we hear about a movie we're excited about, and we start digging, and it's like 2 years before the movie even comes out. So by the time the movie comes out, we've gone through IMDb a few times.
Well, speaking of that, let me do a quick segue here. Of course, Captain America: Civil War is coming out next year, and we will see our first appearance of the brand new Spider-Man. And the actor that's going to play him was announced this week, and it is Tom Holland.
Yay!
Another Brit.
Another Brit, and nobody knows who he is. Like, he's only appeared in like two big movies.
Is it possible to have like Spider-Man fatigue? Because I think I'm suffering from chronic Spider-Man fatigue. I just don't care. I feel bad because you know what? Spider-Man was my favorite character growing up. That was the dude character. Because I was a big Wonder Woman fan. By the way, where's our freaking Wonder Woman movie?
Yeah, no kidding.
That's been in like production for how long now? I'm starting to feel like it's a kid now. Like, is it 18 now? I feel like we've been going back and forth about Wonder Woman movie, and then we got a different director, and then we got a writer, and now we have a different writer. That's just like, I could care less about Spider-Man. When are we getting our freaking Wonder Woman movie?
Well, it's on the schedule, right? It's scheduled for a release.
Yeah, it's been scheduled for release for a while. I don't know. So anyway, with Spider-Man, I was raised on the TV show from the 70s. I don't know if you guys remember that.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
So that was like, I loved that Spider-Man. And then I loved the cartoon that was the really trippy 1970s Spider-Man cartoon. That at one point, you know that the writers were doing a lot of LSD because all of a sudden he was time traveling into a world through a... What was it, that one episode? It was an episode where he got trapped in a freezer, because that was like a trope that all TV shows did with their characters. At some point, they get trapped in like the walk-in freezer at any restaurant, and then the whole episode revolves around that. And he goes like slightly insane, and then he time travels to a world where there's cavemen. Like, I distinctly remember that Spider-Man cartoon being really crazy. That's the kind of movie I want to see. I'm tired of... I know this isn't going to be an origin story, but I'm just kind of tired of Spider-Man. Like, there's so many other characters. Like, I'm excited for Doctor Strange, not just because it's being Cumberbatched, but because it's a different character. I'm excited for, like, Captain Marvel. I'm excited for Ant-Man. I'm excited for any character that's not the same characters we keep getting movies for. And it's just, I'm not trying to be Spider-Man hate right now, but I'm tired of Spider-Man. Like, there's so many other characters that haven't even had movies yet from this universe that we could be, like, geeking over. So,
well, the good news is, Bonnie, he's going to be a very minor character in Captain America's Civil War, because they've already got half the film filmed. So he's going to just be introduced in this, and then his own movie is going to be released, Brad, what, 2018?
2018.
Yeah.
So wait, so how, if he's barely being in the movie, is he just basically gonna like go get them coffee? Is he like the coffee boy? Like, I don't, like, do we just see him for a second going, here's your Frappuccino, bye, I'll see you later in my own movie. Like, is that...
I think they're gonna probably just kind of ease him into the universe and have him do maybe smaller appearances in other films, and then he'll get his solo film. So
because they've said that somebody said, who's the president of Marvel? Kevin Feige, right?
Marvel Studios, yeah.
Yeah. Kevin Feige. He said that Peter Parker and Spider-Man does exist in this universe right now. So he's already out there slinging webs and doing things. He just hasn't appeared on any films yet. So.
Okay. But they're not going to, like, special edition the movies and just stick them in, right?
No,
it's not like Hayden Christensen ghost type situation.
I have to say, I'm kind of reassured by the idea that Spider-Man in the Marvel Universe and the MCU, as you've seen it, is existent, but we haven't heard of him, which means he's more the Spider-Man that we were used to from the earlier comics, where he occasionally fights a supervillain, but mostly goes after burglars and thugs.
Which
is more the Spider-Man that I kind of want to see. Like, obviously, yeah, having him fight a supervillain is important. But
I would love to see petty criminal Spider-Man, too. Like, I feel like I'm just kind of tired of it always being art, like these huge villains or these huge terrorists. Like, you know, there's plenty of jerks that are kind of like, I would say, maybe Law and Order realm or CSI realm. I mean, that aren't mass murderers / serial killers, but they're just people that are doing bad things that need to be caught. Like, I'm cool with that.
Even if they are serial killers, do they have to be serial killers with a plan to destroy an entire city? Can't they just be...
They're not that organized. I mean, they really aren't. They, serial killers, usually it's
they're because... crazy, right?
Crazy
and organized don't
I mean, they're,
go out together.
It depends on the kind of crazy.
Yeah, I guess it would be kind of OCD, like the Dollhouse Killer in CSI. Or I mean, if you're talking real-life serial killers, most of them just kill, you know, either a girl that looks like the first girl that ever rejected them, like Ted Bundy did, or they're going after a very specific type of person.
It's all about whatever matches their paraphilia. So
yeah, it's not going to be...
We could go deep on this.
I mean, that's why...
I have a fascination with serial killers. It's probably not healthy.
Serial killers over random murderers, because serial killers at least have a plan that you can, like, it's kind of like the difference between a tornado and an earthquake. You know when the tornado's coming and you can, like, take precautions, whereas random death is like earthquake, so it's just you don't know when it's going to happen and who it's going to happen to. So I like serial killers, because then I'd be like, if they're just going after blondes, I'm okay. If they're going after brunettes with glasses, I'll just wear contacts and red dye hair. I mean, I feel like I can live with that. But if they're going after, you know, just randomly killing people, then it sucks because everyone's gonna.
A couple of clarifications. 2017 is the Sony Spider-Man movie, and we'll have more like ground level stuff with Netflix. Bonnie, have you seen Daredevil?
I love Daredevil. So this is why I love Daredevil. He does not have a superpower. It's just a dude that's really good at kicking. Like, that's why I really like him, is because, first of all, the one-shot fighting scenes are amazing.
Oh, episode 2, was it? Wasn't it episode 2 or 3, that long shot that was just one camera shot?
And it was cool because then you started to see other Marvel properties do that as well. So there was that one, I don't want to spoil Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. for you.
They have incredible fights on that show.
Oh my god, Sky, when she went, like, when you figured out, oh my god, Sky did some really massively good training with May, and she did that one long shot episode of her just, like, grabbing the guns and shooting. It was, like, amazing. I was like, okay, someone's been watching Daredevil, because Daredevil's like that. When you watch it, you're like, you know, he gets winded. That's awesome that they show that they finally show a character who's a guy that's doing martial arts, and you show him getting tired and getting hit and getting hurt. And he doesn't, like, he's not Wolverine or Deadpool. He doesn't instantly heal. You know, he's basically a dude that's like everybody else, but he's blind. And because he's blind, he, you know, basically got this training to figure out how to, I don't know. I'm a big fan of superheroes that don't have superpowers, who aren't billionaires.
You might be looking forward to the Punisher, whose superpower is having guns.
Yes. Like, to me, if your superpower is you're good with guns and you're good at kicking, I love you. Because I'm tired of superpowers and I'm tired of billionaires. Maybe it's because I live in San Francisco and I'm just automatically tired of billionaires, but...
And superpowers, god damn it, San Francisco.
The only superpower in San Francisco is, like, how do I parallel park my Tesla out front of the artisanal donut shop?
In the comics, Daredevil comes
to... It's not badmouth donuts, please.
Doesn't it? Brad.
What's that?
Doesn't Daredevil come to San Francisco eventually in the comics? Like, he relocates out there?
Maybe it depends on who is writing him. Hell's Kitchen in New York was where he is supposed to be and was. Okay. So
there.
All right. Yeah. All right. Well,
New York now is artisanal donut shops, and it's like Park Slope. It's like, Hell's Kitchen now is so, like, hipster that it's hard to imagine Daredevil in the hip. Daredevil wouldn't be able to afford that place in Hell's Kitchen. So I feel like he's probably, I don't know, where's the last place that's poor in New York right now? Times Square? I don't know.
Nowhere in New York City.
Yeah, so I feel like it's weird because I always care about those things. Like, if you're going to have it in a real world city, be realistic with how rent and how they can afford things. Like, it always cracks me up when I think they're superheroes in a warehouse.
I think with the way they've structured the world is that after the Battle of New York, I'm sure that property values took a digger.
Yeah. So. I feel like that, too. I think that the only way you get a cheap apartment in New York is if after that war happened.
Yeah. there's pieces of... The reason he got so cheap rent is there was pieces of Qatari technology in the building or something like that. Yeah,
that's the only reason I moved to Tokyo is after Godzilla.
Yeah, because you know there's a certain span of time between Godzilla and Kaiju attacks. So if you go right after, that's when you've got the longest, you know, estimated time of not having your building destroyed.
The only problem is Kaiju insurance is really high, so yeah. I don't know if that would work. I always think that would be a great episode for Marvel to do a web series of an insurance agent before and after the war. Like, how great would that be?
Marvel had a comic book series. I can't remember the name, but it was called about the poor bastards who clean up after superheroes.
It was called Damage Control. And
that was way before its time, because if that came out today, it would sell like gangbusters.
Yeah, it's called
gangbusters?
Is it Marvel?
Yes, it was Marvel, and it was Damage Control, and it was a construction company that was specifically called to fix, like, the Baxter building. That was like a running gag, as they had to go and fix the Baxter building again. You know.
Speaking of Daredevil, it kind of reminds me of the Night Nurse, because, you know, she's always there, and she's just, you never know how these superheroes get fixed up, but it's the Night Nurse.
And the cool thing is that's Rosario Dawson, and she's going to be in the Jennifer Jones series as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know, all the Netflix superhero Marvel stuff, all those characters, it's in the same universe. So those characters are going to be interacting. A lot of the side characters are going to be going cross, which I love cross-pollinating shows like that. I mean, I was a big fan of that with Lady Sif and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I was like, that's awesome. But I'm a big, like, I love any kind of crossover, so the Arrow Flash stuff was great too.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about the Flash and Arrow. You have even more of that coming up in the new season with the Legends of Tomorrow. So
Legends of Tomorrow though seems a little goofy. I'm hoping it's not. I'm hoping that it's got sort of some of the grittiness of Arrow, but also some of the heart of Flash. Because to me, Arrow and Flash are two different, very different audiences. Arrow to me is more of a dark character, a dark show, whereas Flash for me started out as a oh golly gee willikers type of show, but I kind of like it grew on me, like I really liked it more and more. But I don't know where this show is supposed to be, this new show is going to be as far as its tone. I don't know if it's supposed to be dark or if it's supposed to be like Flash or if it's supposed to be its own thing. But I'm excited for it, but I'm also hoping it doesn't turn out to be a little overboard goofy, so...
Like Birds of Prey.
It might kind of swing between the two of them, kind of establishing good contrast between drama and humor, which would make it a challenging to write but interesting series.
I mean, it's hard, too, because I'm such a pro... maybe it's my feminist flag, but I'm so for female superheroes getting their own shows, and, like, when I saw that preview for Supergirl, I wanted to slit my wrists because it just looked like Devil Wore Prada, and it was just horrible, and I like romantic comedies, but I don't want Supergirl to be a romantic comedy. Like, I don't want it to be that Black Widow spoof commercial that SNL did. Like, I don't want it.
You know what? I'm optimistic that it's not going to be exactly like that, but it's certainly not going to be, like, dark, gritty, super feminist either.
I know, but it's like, you know, if you remember Birds of Prey, I thought that that show was really cool, and I thought they did a really good job of showing.
That's another thing that was ahead of its time. That would come out today, it would be amazing. But back then, I don't think it was able to capture a proper audience.
I think Brad disagrees.
That maybe it was that time that female characters were just respected a little bit more than they are now. I don't know what's going on with, like, Hawk Girl is getting her own series. So I'm stoked.
That's not entirely confirmed. Actually,
don't ruin my dreams. Yeah,
the actress is like, I haven't heard anything about that.
Are you serious?
So, yeah.
Oh, bloggers.
All right. Yep. Hey, before we get in the fight, let's move on to the next subject.
Wait. I have a question for Bonnie because she's knows superheroes and feminists. What's your opinion of the fact that most, if not like the large majority of superhero female superheroes are always Hawk Girl, which is a female version of Hawk Man, or Supergirl, a female version of Superman,
or She-Hulk?
Is it annoying? Because that's one of the things that kind of bothers me is that I would love to see, and this goes also for the racial aspects, like, I love Miles Morales, but at the same time, why does it have to be Black Spider-Man? Why can't it just be that hero who happens to be black? Why can't it just be that hero that happens to be a woman, and they're their own thing instead of being the version of?
I think the thing with that is, from the beginning of comics, they always had to have man or boy in the title of the character, whether it was Superman or Batman or, Robin even has boy in his subtext title, right?
Boy Wonder. Yes.
Yeah. So there's always been that gender identification with dudes. So I think when it had the female equivalent, they just did the female equivalent. I don't think of it as sexist. I think it's just, that's how superheroes are called. But I do like your idea of, especially now that I think Marvel and DC are paying closer attention at diversifying their characters. So in movies, sometimes you'll see characters that were usually white in the comics, now they're black in the movies, or they're Hispanic or Asian. Like, I want more of that. I also want more superheroes that identify as not straight. That would be nice for a change. Like, it would be nice if maybe Daredevil's gay, or maybe Wonder Woman is bi. Like,
well, you know, and somebody raised, I can't remember which actress it was, and she raised a good point that, I think it was Michelle Fast and Furious.
Rodriguez.
Yeah, and she made the point, why are you making those heroes, you know, you're converting them to another race, another gender or something. Why can't we have original stuff?
See, that's exactly, you know? That's the question I'm asking. Like, there are, even if there weren't, but there are heroes that are already of those, like, or either sexual orientation, gender, or race.
Yes.
Why aren't they being brought to the forefront instead of taking, like, a male hero, making it female, because... Why? I don't know. And maybe, well, I'm not the right person as a white heterosexual male to be asking the question, because I don't have the background that goes with it. But,
well, they're not making male heroes female. It's just that those female characters, I mean, a lot of those female characters have existed just as long as those, you know, male guys. So, like, Wonder Woman's been around forever.
Wonder Woman is a good example, because she's not, like, there's no Wonder Man, or if there is, like, he's
no, in Marvel.
Equivalent.
So. Sorry, the comic book encyclopedia is in the room. So
yeah.
Wonder Woman has a very spotty origin history as far as sexism, though.
I totally get what you're saying, and I understand. And the problem here, first of all, is Hollywood. They're not going to give us the diversity we want unless all of us want it, and that's because money. So they won't take risks. Like, the fact that we even got Joss Whedon to direct a Marvel, like, to direct the Avengers in the first place is remarkable, considering he was rejected for Wonder Woman from DC. So,
well, that's Time Warner not being able to make a decent decision to save their lives.
For a while, Marvel couldn't either, and I'm still shocked that we got Joss. I mean, I'm stoked that we did, but that was a huge risk for Marvel. I mean, it really was.
No, not really, because if you were to look at any director, I think, that can do a larger ensemble cast, mm-hmm. and give everybody an equal voice, make them all interesting characters, his track record for what he put together for Buffy, for Angel, for even the writing that he did for Astonishing X-Men for Marvel, he could do, and he understands the dynamic that you need to have with characters to, one, make them interesting, even as a group, not just individually, but to have human interactions.
We know that as fans. We're not in charge of major billion-dollar companies, and those people, unless they are fans to begin with, aren't going to agree with what you just said. All they want is to say they want a big director who can bring in butts into seats, and they want to be able to make as much money as possible on characters that already have a huge following. That's what Hollywood is right now.
Yes,
because
yes.
Using that argument, we should be able to get... I mean, James Gunn did such a great job with Guardians of the Galaxy, but that was a risk as well for Marvel because he really wasn't doing those kinds of movies. But I'm glad Marvel's taking his risks, but honestly, I'm shocked they are. I'm glad they are. No.
And that's the smartest thing that they could ever do. Because looking at DC, the only successful stuff that they've really done recently has been the Chris Nolan Batman stuff. But any time that there is a risk to be taken, Batman's a proven property.
Yeah.
You know, they okay, well, let me...
Well, Batman's like Spider-Man.
After you get past the Schumacher years, it's a proven
You and I will need to have a discussion that will probably take around 2.5 to 3 hours about Man of Steel, but...
Oh, but...
I totally get what you're saying, and I'm not arguing with you. Like, I believe you 100%. It's just, I know how the sausage is made.
Yeah.
In the industry. I know exactly how the sausage is made. I mean, and unfortunately, that's ruined a lot of my... Kind of like my, because I'm a huge movie fan and I'm a huge superhero fan. I love sci-fi, I love fantasy, I love horror. But working at Lucasfilm for 10 years, I now know how these decisions are made, and it's horrifying. It is horrifying that a lot of the people that make these decisions don't love the properties they're making decisions on. It's horrifying that most of them don't even know any of the comics. You know, it's great that we're starting to see more and more people at Marvel and DC that are actual fans or writers or who are embedded in that culture, who actually interact with fans on social media and they want to know your opinion. But for a long time, there was a giant, like, East Berlin, West Berlin wall between the people making movies and the people going to movies.
If I can interject some optimism, though, one thing that's interesting is, like, right now we're seeing, like, if you go back 20 years, no one that was approving or directing or making movies knew anything about superheroes and stuff like that. Now we're starting to see more and more of the nerds sort of filter through and start to take up these jobs. But seeing how today, like, right now, superheroes, nerd stuff, science fiction is very mainstream, go forward 20 years, almost everyone that's going to be the decision makers will be aware of the properties that they'll be dealing with, or at least their genres. They're not going to say, science fiction, whatever. Like, they'll know, like, they'll be saying, oh, science fiction, like those shows I used to love and enjoy and those movies I used to love and enjoy. So the future is probably incredibly bright as far as those bigwigs taking decisions, at least I'm hoping so.
Well, I mean, technically, Star Wars was a mainstream movie. So it wasn't like sci-fi was indie. It had an indie feel because everyone was against George making decisions that they didn't understand. Like, if we had left it up to the executives, Chewbacca would be wearing pants. You know?
But at the same time, if I look at a lot of people that are right now saying they're 60s or late 50s, and I say, is Star Wars something that you loved? It's still a coin flip to see if they did. So, but...
Well, I guess to me it depends on what your sci-fi favorites were in the 60s and 70s. I think a lot of them were into Star Trek because that show was so prevalent in the 60s. And then you get Planet of the Apes, which was actually more of a shout-out about civil rights than it was about sci-fi, but it was still a sci-fi movie. I mean, it just depends, I guess, on who you talk to. But, I mean, I'm hopeful for the future. It's just what I'm excited for is what Netflix is doing. I'm a big fan of them taking a lot of risks, letting fans vote on what they want, and they're saving shows. Like Hulu and Netflix, if you get something canceled, it might come back on their platform, and will get it. Like, I know Mindy Project did that.
Mindy Project, yep.
Even at Netflix or Hulu when Firefly was canceled, maybe we would have gotten Firefly on Hulu or Netflix because they pick up these shows because they know that there's a huge audience for them. And if the major networks like NBC, Fox, CBS, ABC don't get it, then maybe they'll be able to pick it up on a different platform. So I'm excited just for Netflix saving shows and Hulu saving shows, but also doing original programming. That's crazy. Like, Daredevil's amazing, and I can't wait for the rest of what Marvel's doing on Netflix. Jennifer Jones is going to be great. I mean, she's one of my favorite characters. I'm not Jennifer, I'm sorry, Jessica Jones. She's one of my favorite characters because she has such a weird side. She has such a bizarre origin story. She went to the same high school as Spider-Man. I mean, she and Peter Parker were in the same class, and she was, like, used and abused and then treated like crap and then rejected by all the superheroes, and now she has a detective agency. So I think that's kind of going to be a cool show in the sense it's something new, and Kristen Ritter is going to be great at it. I'm just excited for that. So I'm excited for what Netflix is doing. I think they're taking a lot of risks. Their number one risk right now is Sense8 from the Wachowski siblings. That's a great sci-fi series, and that was that. Talk about doing some diversity. I mean, they have a trans character, they have gay characters, they have a poly couple, and then they have like your traditional Chicago cop, you know, as a character. And they're doing a lot of diversity on that show. And I hope that when people watch Sense8, they see, oh, this is what sci-fi could be. We could have a bunch of characters of color and of different sexual orientations and from different countries. Like, sci-fi people, sci-fi fans are not afraid to read subtitles. So it's good to have that mix, and I'm kind of hoping that Marvel and DC take a look at some of the other sci-fi and fantasy that are taking risks right now and take a page out of that book. Sorry, I just got on a soapbox.
No, it's okay.
No. And I agree. Like, distribution, the way distribution is moving right now is super exciting. So, like, there's nothing you said that I don't agree with.
Let me interject here with a question for you guys. So, if there were to be a Star Wars TV show...
Which there will be.
Okay. I'm trying to do a really creative segment here.
Spoiler. Here, I'm going to turn on a light. Go ahead.
Okay, do you think if they did a Star Wars TV show, would it be on a streaming service or one of the networks? Because our next and final story in the news section, Star Wars rumors... Michael Maclaren in talks for a version of Underworld, and as you might know, George Lucas a few years ago was working on a live-action Star Wars TV show, and it seems that they may be bringing it back.
And I'm going to tell you a secret right now, which won't be a secret because I don't work for them anymore, so I don't care.
I was wondering if you had some kind of insight on this.
I do, because they were working on that show when I was there, and I'm just going to tell you right now, the screenwriter, or the writers, the writer room for the show is the best of the best. Like, think Sopranos, think Wired, or The Wire, think...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I mean, these are... Think Battlestar Galactica. Yeah, these are the writers that did the show, and... I had hoped that the show had been released when I was there because I was so wanting an adult show. Like, I love Star Wars Clone Wars. I love Star Wars Rebels. I think there's some great, even though that's kids programming and it's on Disney right now, there's some great shout-outs to Ralph McQuarrie. If you watch the most recent one, they showed Darth Vader, and that was Ralph McQuarrie's original Darth Vader design. They have a lot of great dialogue, a lot of great characters. A lot of great female characters in Star Wars Clone Wars that may never see the light of day in the movies, but Dave Filoni did such a great job with those characters in that show. But those are for kids. Like, I want Star Wars Sopranos. I want Star Wars for adults. I don't want necessarily to always have it be for kids or PG-13. And this TV series was supposed to be, I mean, when we got it pitched to us, George Lucas himself said, I want Deadwood in space. I want there to be cursing, I want there to be sex, I want there to be violence, and I want this to be for adults. And that's what this was supposed to be. This was supposed to be like Deadwood meets Sopranos in space. It was supposed to be the underworld. It's supposed to be the gangsters. It's supposed to be the Hutts as kind of like a Godfather situation. You know, it's supposed to be violent and gritty, but in this world that we all know and love. Mm-hmm. And I was so angry when it got shelved, and I knew it was going to get shelved because Disney... bought the company, and there's this whole rollout program of all the movies, just like Seth Green's show got shelved. I mean, that was supposed to be coming out too, and that was for, it was kind of a weird thing for kids. It wasn't Robot Chicken for kids, but it was a Star Wars show, an animated show, and that had been done, and that was ready to go, and that was pushed back because Rebels, because they wanted to cancel Clone Wars and bring on Rebels. So I'm hoping that this show happens. I know this rumor has been going around, but the show does exist. I can tell you that. I can tell you it's probably done.
50 scripts. Mm-hmm. 50 scripts.
Yeah, the scripts are done. They're just wanting to shoot it. And I'm just hoping this happens soon because, you know, we're supposed to get a new Star Wars movie every year after Awakens comes out. So I don't know. I'm hoping that it happens soon, but maybe they're waiting to see what the streaming service, to see how Netflix, Amazon Prime, God forbid Yahoo, whatever that. By the way, how do you even watch stuff on Yahoo? I still don't understand how I'm going to watch stuff on Yahoo as a show, like Netflix. Or anyway, that's a different thing.
But I've chosen my answer for that is that I won't until they make it easier.
Exactly.
Because, yeah.
Force people to download a browser, download this or download that. It has to be where they already are. So either go to Netflix or Yahoo or YouTube or Amazon Prime, I guess. But still, it should be accessible. I mean, if HBO Go and Showtime and all those guys have figured out that you need to do streaming for cord cutters, then you should make it easy. But well, I'm hoping that the show ends up on either Showtime or HBO because it needs to have that kind of Game of Thrones adultness to it. And you can't do that on Sci-Fi Channel. And you can't do that on Fox. And you can't do that on NBC, ABC, CBS. So it better be on either Showtime or HBO, even Stars. I'll take Stars. I don't care. It's got to be on a network where they can swear and have sex. That's basically
Stars is on the rise. They've got a couple of projects that they're working on.
They've got some great stuff. I mean, they have the Evil Dead show, right? That's supposed to be on Stars. Outlander's on Stars.
Yeah. There's another one that they're working on right now. I forget what it is, but
yeah, I don't think it matters anymore what your network is as long as you're willing to take risks and you can be seen. Like, as long as it's accessible and you take risks and you do stuff that fans want, they'll go. I mean, I'll go to a brand new network if it means, you know, I get something that I've been wanting forever. So, I don't know. I don't think that matters as much. I just hope that whatever Disney and Lucasfilm decide, they don't dumb it down. They keep the scripts as is because the writer room was magnificent and they're amazing writers on this project. And they do a good job casting because I think if anything Star Wars fans are adamant about is don't give us a bad cast. And I think that's great that with Force Awakens we have such a diverse, interesting cast. But it would be great if that kept going. Even the voice acting casts of Clone Wars and Rebels are magnificent.
Who did the voice, by the way, of Darth Vader for Rebels?
James Earl Jones. Yeah, he came back for it. How cool is that, right?
That's cool.
And also, Lando Calrissian was done by Billy Dee Williams.
Yep.
So we see a lot of that where you have the original cast going, yeah, I'll do it. And just the fact that James Earl Jones came back to do Darth Vader's voice is just great. I love that he did that for
Look
Rebel.
What we have here.
I mean, I love that they're doing young Lando for Rebels because you kind of get that like that young swagger. And I hope for Underworld they bring in, because there's always been that hint that you actually get to see the scene, maybe, of how the Millennium Falcon keeps getting lost in poker games. Not poker, the back, you know. I feel like that would be fun, but I'm for a Hutt. I've always been for a Hutt Sopranos.
Well, part of the story is the rumors that were circulating about that second anthology film were actually rumors surrounding the TV show about a young Boba Fett and Han Solo. So
yeah, that was the thing that everyone thought they were going to get a Han Solo movie and a young Boba Fett movie. I think that was part of Underworld. But here's the thing, like, everything can change. Like, I have no idea. Like, I stopped guessing what Lucasfilm's going to do. Even when I worked there, like, I thought Indiana Jones, the next Indiana Jones movie, was going to be the Atlantis script, and it wasn't. It was Shia LaBeouf running after things on a motorcycle.
No.
I know, we can't say Shia. Here's the problem. I'm so scared of Shia being cast in anything Lucasfilm now.
My worry with things like Underworld and the Boba Fett, and I've mentioned this on this program before, this program, I'm like 50, is that a lot of what makes these characters and events, like these, like the Kessel Run and the Millennium Falcon being won in a card game, is the fact that we don't have details, the fact that these things are kind of steeped in mystery is what gives them that mystique. I'm worried that digging too deep into how it happened might just... It won't live up to what we've imagined, you know?
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. I don't want Boba Fett to be Lucasfilm's version of Spider-Man. I don't want 60 Boba Fett movies. I don't want 50 Han Solo movies. I want a Thrawn trilogy. I want an Old Republic movie. I want them to go, and I know that they've said that the EU Expanded Universe is kind of thrown out the window, and they'll take what they want, but they'll change what they want, and it's not going to be canon as we know it, and blah, blah, blah. But there's so many great books and comics in the Star Wars universe that could be their own movies that don't have the main characters. Or even if they do have main characters, it's like they kind of go through... Like, I would love a Death Troopers horror film. Like, if you read the book Death Troopers, which was Lucasfilm's first real horror book, and it was a zombie book, and it's really horrific, and it's amazing. Like, what happens if a zombie virus hits all the stormtroopers? What happens in that moment? Like, what are you going to do? And it's such a great book, and there are some cameos of major characters in there. I don't want to spoil it for anyone who hasn't read it, but then there's a prequel called Red Harvest that's really good, too. So those would make great movies, but whether or not Lucasfilm Disney is going to make a Star Wars horror film as opposed to a Star Wars sci-fi film, I don't know. Like, I would love to see all these books and comics and video games. There's Battlefront would make such a great movie, and there's so many great Star Wars video games that the writing is so great in them that they could work well as a movie. So I don't know. I'm hoping they do that and don't just give us the main characters over and over and over and over.
Okay.
No, the way I see it is, I see the extended universe as kind of a proof of concept that you can make good Star Wars stories away from the main character and away from the main plot line that we've seen in the movies so far. What I don't want to, and as much as some of the EU is amazing, these stories have kind of been told, and yeah, it might be cool to see them told in a different medium, but now that we know we can tell different stories, bring them on. Bring on some new stuff. Bring on some new stories. Get some of these writers that have been, like, tripping on Star Wars for, like, their entire youth and teenage years and young adult years. Get them to write new stuff. And, okay, we haven't lost the EU, but, okay, the extended universe is not canon anymore. Who cares? That just means there's now room for more cool stuff, and that's what I want to see. I want to see some new cool shit.
Okay, let's move on to our discussion topic this week, which I think we'll get some cool stuff out of this. Big question is, what genre of science fiction would you like to see become more popular again, or like subgenre of science fiction? Like right now we've got the superhero genre. That's the big one. We've got space operas making a comeback. Dystopian fiction is kind of waning a little bit. So what genre or subgenre of science fiction that is a favorite of yours that you would like to see come back? Who wants to go first?
I'll let other people go first because I've been talking too much and I have to go turn on a light so it doesn't look like I'm slowly dying in the dark.
Okay.
I'm going to go first here.
All right. Go ahead, Brad.
I would go with horror sci-fi. I want good stuff. I want, like, alien suspense horror. I want well thought out, dramatic, thematic, really good horror sci-fi.
Yeah, and, like Alien Mareffer.
Well, Alien 2, everything else can die in a fire.
yes, I agree. Alien 3 and especially Alien 4. I don't care that Joss Whedon wrote it. It's trash, but whatever.
What would be another good example of that?
Of, as much as people might trash it, Event Horizon.
Oh, that was
wait, no, Event Horizon had a lot of stupid mistakes, but they're mostly technical things, but thematically it was great.
Thematically it was beautiful. The ending
borrowed heavily from Warhammer 40K, but whatever.
Well, it borrowed a lot from H.P. Lovecraft. So, I mean, I would love to see, you know, really well thought out thematic horror that also works in a sci-fi environment and deals with technology not necessarily gone astray, but mankind wanting to do something with technology and not asking the question, should I, other than, you know, instead of can I?
There was an interesting article on IO9, I want to say, about how space makes one of the best horror settings because of its level of isolation and the fact that you can't just run away.
Yeah. No,
and
absolutely.
It was a great article, and it ties really well into what you're saying in that bringing back sci-fi horror allows us to do this, like having supernatural elements in space or just having space horror with aliens or whatever, doing something creative and interesting and really scary can be
like
fun.
If you guys have not seen the movie Moon, it is not necessarily horror, but it is definitely suspense with elements of horror. Potentially, depending on where you think that the story is going.
So more Moon, less Apollo 18.
Oh, yeah. I'd rather be punched in the genitals than watch Apollo 18.
I can accommodate that.
And this is my favorite genre, too, is I love space horror, but Last Days on Mars was also one of my favorite ones with Liev Schreiber, and that was zombie movie. It's on Netflix now. If you have Netflix, you should watch it. But that was you're at a space station that gets a weird virus, which I love that premise. Because where do you go to hide when your oxygen's over there and the zombies are where the oxygen is? Like, what do you do when you're in, and you have no backup, and basically everyone you're with starts dying around you? Like, I love that premise because it's, one, it's just suffocating, and two, it's just it's like this weird claustrophobic situation where you're in space, which should be vast, but your oxygen is over there. It's just, it's crazy. And I love that genre, and I feel like that's perfect for Star Wars. That's perfect for another Aliens-type movie. That's perfect for, you know, we need more of this, especially now that we're doing much more space exploration, and there's a lot more of privatizing space exploration.
Oh, yeah.
I think Alien definitely pinpointed, you know, what can go wrong when businesses are in space exploration. Yeah.
That's the ultimate bad result of private company.
Yeah, exactly. But I when scientists let science get in the way of preserving humanity. Like, if they like, oh, well, there's a brand new species I want to dissect back at Houston, bring it on home. Like, they don't really put the two together that maybe you shouldn't bring it on home. But I love the idea of more space horror. I think that's great. And you actually brought up something that I wanted to say in my suggestion was Lovecraft. I think that H.P. Lovecraft, there's so much there still. We still don't have a decent Cthulhu movie.
No.
And I would love a decent Cthulhu movie, and I don't know how they could do it without making it too much like a comedy like Grabbers was. If you haven't seen that, it's a great monster film. Cloverfield, you know, I loved Cloverfield, but I wanted some more science, less, you know, shaky cam monster. So I would love an H.P.
In the Mouth of Madness? Have you seen In the Mouth of Madness by John Carpenter? Because that's very much it's probably the only done-ish Lovecraftian movie.
Yeah, I love that movie. I mean, it's been such a long time, and I don't know, because H.P. Lovecraft fans, and I'm one of them, we're so picky, and we don't want...
Yeah.
Lovecraft is so hard, and most of what's described is, like, part of what makes his eldritch horrors so tantalizing and interesting is that they are indescribable. They are, like, impossible physical configurations. How do you put that on film?
I think you could do that. There are movies that were done that you don't see the monster, or you
No, and those are the best. And I'm not saying it's impossible, but it's way more challenging than saying, yeah, we're going to have an alien and lots, just tentacles, just everywhere.
Yeah, like to me, I like anything that's H.P. Lovecraft or any kind of sci-fi or horror where you don't have all the pieces, where it's not spoon-fed to you, where as soon as you're done watching the movie, you're like, what did I just watch? I want to watch it again because I feel like this is a puzzle. Like, this is something that's what Lost felt like for me before it was ruined at the end. For me, Lost was like a giant puzzle that we would all talk about at work or online or at parties, where we try to figure out what does this all mean? Like, what is all of this? I love any kind of TV series or movie where you're like, I have to watch this three times to understand it because it's so complex and so interesting.
Oh.
And I feel like we need more of that instead of just spoon-fed stuff.
Bonnie, I don't know, maybe you've seen this, but Wayward Pines, my wife and I love that because there was
I have a M. Night Shyamalan Ding Dong fan in this house, so I don't... I know he didn't write it, he's just directing it, so that's probably why it's good. I started watching it, and I really liked it because it did seem kind of like other shows that had been canceled that I loved, like Happy Town. Happy Town, I don't know if you ever saw that on ABC. It only ran for 10 episodes, and then they canceled it because everyone was like, oh, it's the new Twin Peaks, and it wasn't. But it was a town that you couldn't escape from, and there was weird things going on, but that was more paranormal, less scientific type stuff. I like Wayward Pines mainly because I think the cast is amazing, and I think the writing is intriguing. But I just hope they don't let us down. And I know it's not an ongoing series. It's a set amount of episodes, which is good because that means hopefully we'll get what we want out of it. But I don't know. I feel like TV has made me so paranoid that I'm worried if I like something, it'll be canceled or won't get the answers I want. Because that happened with Park Avenue 666. That happened with Happy Town. That happened with Defying Gravity. That happened with, I mean, I've lost count of how many shows that had a weird sci-fi element to it that we were supposed to get, like, a cool ending, and we never got the ending. Like, I still wake up in the middle of the night going, how did Defying Gravity end? It did it!
What about that time travel show that was on, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago? And I forget the name of it. It was set in San Francisco, actually.
Okay.
What was it called? Oh man, I forget now.
Time travel show?
What's that?
It was a time travel show.
Yeah, he was a cop.
Oh, it wasn't. New Amsterdam. That was different than Forever. Was it Forever?
No, it wasn't Forever.
Maybe
it was Forever. I forget now.
Was he immortal?
No, he wasn't. He was just.
I just do want to chime this in. If there is one more freaking show based on a comic I love turned into a cop procedural because they can't handle just doing the comic, and I'm looking at you, Lucifer, because Lucifer is one of my favorite comics from Vertigo. It is not a freaking cop procedural, and they turned it into a cop procedural. It doesn't even air till 2016, but I saw the intro for it. I wrote about it for CNET, and I was like, I don't remember there being a cop procedural in the comic, and I'm worried about that. I'm worried about American Gods because I want that to be so good, and that's going to be made into a TV show. I'm worried about Preacher. That's going to be a TV show. I swear to God, if they make these all into like CSI Law and Order shows, I'm going to be pissed off because they did that with Constantine. And granted, Constantine does have sort of a cop procedural type thing, but how off base were they with that comic? It's like, come on. Like, I really want these Vertigo shows, these Vertigo comics to TV shows to do better. And Constantine actually got me in the end. I actually liked it. And then, of course, because I liked it, they canceled it. So
stop liking things.
I'm gonna say two words. Almost human. I was so pissed.
Oh, I really loved that. I loved that so much, and that's why it was canceled, because it had Carl in it. And because it had so many great Blade Runner like shout outs.
And those two characters had such good chemistry. It was amazing.
It was so good. And I loved that show. I loved the cast. I mean, it was such a great, the writing was great. And each episode, it almost felt like Black Mirror. I don't know if you've ever watched that show.
Yep.
But Black Mirror, it's a UK show. That's kind of like they call it like a UK Twilight Zone, but it's not really Twilight Zone. It's each episode's its own episode. It's not a story arc.
Yeah, it's an anthology series.
I loved how much that they predicted the future. I mean, when you look at Black Mirror and you say, okay, these things could actually happen, and then you look at Almost Human, there are things in Almost Human where I'm like, yeah, that's happening. Yes, that's happening. Like, drone surveillance is not going away, people. That's going to be forever now. We have Probot. Like, that's just deal with it. That's now what our life is. NSA has been watching us forever. It's only going to get worse. I mean, all these, all robotics, like family robotics, helper robotics, that's all happening. That's not going away. We are going to get humanoid robots in our house to do the dishes and walk our dogs. That's not science fiction anymore. That's happening. And
okay. Dave, you know my opinion on robots, so you can imagine how I feel about that being canceled.
What is?
Robots are my jam. So
JF wrote a book about robots.
Yeah, I love robots. I love any show with a robot in it, and I don't care how lame it is. I will love that robot. Like, I was a big Buck Rogers and 20th Century fan, and I love Twilight.
Let's not get carried away. Like, I personally disagree that we're going to see humanoid robots because it's not the most useful form, but we're going to see a lot more robotics in our homes in various forms.
Pepper was the robot that just sold this week, and it outsold, and it's humanoid-esque. Like, it's not, like, it doesn't have skin. It doesn't look like the show Human, which just came out, right? It's not that. It's not like we're going to get sex bots anytime soon. There's no cherry
tea. Oh, no, no. We're totally getting sex bots.
That's
the porn industry and ew.
There's a CNET article that went out last week where, you know, Real Doll, the people that make the sex dolls that look super realistic, they just partnered with a robotics company. So they're actually going to make their Real Dolls animatronic. They're not going to necessarily have AI, but they're going to be like really sexy Chuck E. Cheese dolls. I mean, when you think about it.
No, I don't want to think about it.
Not sexy Chuck E. Cheese. That was a horrible analogy. That was like a Deliverance analogy. I'm sorry. No, it's not going to be gross hillbilly furries. It's going to be like, you know, they're going to be sexy. Anyway, my point is that Pepper, which was it's a companion robot for the household, that looks sort of human, but not really. The problem with robotics and helper robots is uncanny valley. Some people want robots to look like humans, and other people are like, please, God, don't do that to us. Don't make robots look like us. Make them look like R2-D2 so I don't feel weird talking to it. Like, just...
Well, I have a feeling that the way it's going to go, we're going to see a lot of sort of humanoid stuff at first to kind of ease us into accepting the idea of robotics in our home, but then the whole humanoid form is going, like, people that are going to innovate beyond that to make things that are more adapted to the tasks that we're going to want the robots to do. So we're probably going to iterate out of humanoids pretty quickly to make more economical, more efficient robots, more suited to their tasks.
Yeah, I mean, I would like a Wumba that actually does the dishes and not just my floors. Like, I would like a robot that does all the crappy stuff I don't want to do. But I don't think that's going to... Like, Roomba robots, even those have flaws. I mean, they can't go downstairs. Those are the
bad... Alone or in pairs. They suck.
Or in pairs. Yeah, they're no slinky robots. They're not... You know, they're not going to do... I want a robot to do my taxes. You know, I want a robot to, like, go to jury duty for me, which would be a great TV series of, instead of you going, you send a robot to jury duty and how that... up the justice system. I would love that show.
Well, there's that Bruce Willis film.
Yeah, where everyone stays at home and their replicants go out, but they're like...
Okay, I'm going to put a cap on that. Screw that movie. Read David Brin's Kiln People, and that is that movie, except, you know, good.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. let's move on to the next person.
Wait. I have a dumb recommendation for a space horror movie, and this is like a guilty pleasure of mine. Like, I haven't seen it in a while, and maybe I'm drunk when I see it, but Hellraiser Bloodline is actually kind of good.
It is.
And if you forget that the...
I was going to say, all the Hellraiser...
Like, I can be out on that for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
I'm down with the Hellraiser movies. I want a new Hellraiser. I don't know if they're like Leprechaun movies. Are there like 10 of them? I don't know how many.
There's too many, and they get really dumb towards the end. I would love to see Clive Barker come back and say, okay, I'll step aside, assholes. I'll do it. I'll take care of it.
That's the thing. I think with sci-fi horror and just horror in general, I would love to see, like, I think, again, I know this sounds like a Joss Whedon love letter, and I do love him. He's like my ideal of what a writer and director combo should be, but I loved Cabin in the Woods, and I think that totally was a great example of how you can make sci-fi and horror and just weirdness and make it just out of the box, like, totally.
It was maybe half a percentage too self-referential, but it was an amazing movie.
I loved it. I loved it. And I want more movies like that. I want movies where you think you're watching one thing, and then halfway through it, you're like, holy crap, this totally blew my mind. Like, I want more sci-fi and horror like that. So I'm hoping that we get more. And I know it's an indie movie, so indie movies tend to take more risks like that, but I hope we get more stuff like that.
Okay, so I'm going to answer my own question. I want, and I have a split answer, because one is more of a subgenre than the other. I'm going to say alternate reality movies, like going from dimension to dimension, a la Sliders, which wasn't really a movie, it was a TV show, but things along those lines. And my second answer is moon base shows and movies. Like, I grew up watching Space 1999, and I've been hoping for a remake of that show, and I heard a story or read a story a couple of years ago that they were remaking it, and I hope that actually comes to fruition.
They lost their funding.
Oh.
I was following that story too, and I was like, yes.
His show to rip his dreams apart.
Sorry, they lost their funding for that one and UFO. Remember, they were going to do a UFO remake too?
No, don't tell me that they're not going to do a Logan's Run anymore, because that's the other one I was hoping for.
They might. I mean, here's the thing. We're kind of in this weird remake reboot vortex right now in Hollywood. So if they're going to reboot Gem, and poorly, I might add, then they're probably going to reboot everything. I mean, I'm getting reboot fatigue on CNET because I keep covering all these stories that are, like, we're supposed to get Galaxy Quest TV show. We're supposed to get a new Stargate movie. We're supposed to be getting, you know, it's like new Big Trouble in Little China. You know, that's getting rebooted with The Rock. I mean, it's like, I feel like everything that we love and everything we know is getting rebooted. So there's always a chance that maybe something you love that you think's not getting its funding, maybe it'll get its funding back. I don't know.
But there's also some really good original sci-fi. I mean, look at all the shows on sci-fi now. You have Dark Matter, which is a fantastic show.
Yeah.
Killjoys, another great program. Then they've got this Expanse show that's going to be coming out. I don't know the release date for that show, but it's based on a great series of books. So that's all original stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's sci-fi, but don't get too attached, because they cancel shows very quickly.
Yeah. All right, so let's move on. Anessa, do you have an answer?
Not really. I mean, there's just so much out there, and it's like, if you can't find it in the form of a movie or a TV show, then there's a ton of books that you can go through if you really want, like, a particular genre, I suppose. I was going to joke and say alien romance.
Yes.
Because, well, I was looking at books and stuff on Amazon last night, and I was doing a search for alien stories, just alien stories, alien short stories, anything UFO themed. And I was really surprised and a bit disturbed at the amount of alien romance books out there.
It's funny that you mentioned that. If you want any of my old ones, because on Vaginal Fantasy Book Club, that's all we do is review any kind of paranormal or sci-fi romance book. Like, this month, because of Jurassic World, I'm covering dinosaur erotica books, which are huge. They're huge. I mean, they're huge.
God, I bet you they're.
yeah.
Books. So one of them's called Eternal Cravings by Nina Bangs. And then the other one's Taken by T-Rex, which is
a real name.
Taken by T-Rex is $1 on Amazon. It's not even $1. It's 99 cents. I think all of you should buy it, because it's horrible, but it's hilarious. And it's
that would really be the only reason to purchase these and read them, is see how ridiculous they are.
If you want, tweet me back and forth, like, after the show, and I'll get your address, your mailing address. We'll talk on email, and I'll just send you a couple of my favorite sci-fi alien romance books that I already have.
And oh, you my could, God!
You could just have them.
There's an audible version of that book taken by the T-Rex.
I have the audible. It's hilarious. The audible, I actually listen to the audible when I'm walking my dog, and it was so funny because I stopped in the middle of walking my dog and just started laughing hilariously, and people were looking at me like I was insane. It is the funniest thing you will listen to. I'm telling you right now, if you get the audible version of Taken by T-Rex, you will not be disappointed.
Can we have a version that's read by Gilbert Gottfried, like the that video yes. of Fifty Shades of Grey?
Yes. Either Gilbert Gottfried or Christopher Walken. I would love it.
Yes. Oh.
Okay.
Okay. After you listen to your weird romance books, you're going to want to drink, right? You're going to want to take the
edge off. I think I might need to drink while I'm...
Wait, playing? You're jumping to the drink already?
Yeah, haven't we gone through everybody? Did anybody
answer? I don't think we did Bonnie or me.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, totally. Well, Bonnie kind of answered, right?
What? What am I answering?
Your answer to the big question.
Oh, about what I wanted to see.
The genre.
Yeah, you want more H.P. Lovecraft.
That either H.P. Lovecraft, but now that you brought up romances, I am totally down for the most bizarre romance sci-fi. It's weird because a lot of our sci-fi show, movies and TV shows that we like, they'll have that element. Like Star Trek definitely has romance in it, whether you watch the old school William Shatner shows or Next Gen or whatever. There's always a romance. There's always a love triangle in one of those. And Star Wars has romance, but it's always ill-fated romance, so I don't know, I don't really count Star Wars. Though when I worked for Lucasfilm, I did pitch a romance book line for Extended Universe that was just going to be romance books, but romances with robots and romances with other characters and even the Hutts, like how did the Hutts meet? Because the Hutt was, Jabba was married. He doesn't just have sex slaves chained to him. He actually was married and had a kid. So
how did he do it? I want to know that.
Well, she's.
No, I don't. No, you don't.
She's in. If you watch the pod race, she's behind him. But the pod race. They're in the. I know that people like to think that prequels don't exist, but if you are one of those people that like the prequels, she's in it. But I feel like, and you know, I always thought Yoda and Yaddle would get together because Yaddle was like. His species, even though he's supposed to be one of his own species. If you watch The Phantom Menace, she's in there. That's the female Yoda. I wanted them to get together and have some Yoda sexy times, but I don't know. Maybe I'm just weird and demented, but I would love a lot of different romance novels to actually happen between certain sci-fi genres and characters. No.
Well, you're part of the vaginal.
Vaginal. It's not, now it sounds like a janitorial service. It's called
Vaginal Fantasy
Book Club. That's all you need to remember. And we're meeting next Tuesday, and we're going to talk about dinosaur erotica, and we do a Google Hangout like this, and you just go to youtube.com/vaginalfantasy, that's our channel, and we have vaginalfantasy.com, which is our Tumblr, and you can look at all the previous episodes, but... you should watch next Tuesday because I have a puppet that I made that's a dinosaur puppet.
What?
Yeah.
Props. Good.
No chance of getting a preview,
right? Yeah, it's going to be pretty epic because I know for a fact that anytime I pick the book, it horrifies Felicia because there was another time I did Cthulhu erotica. Yeah. And those books are great. It's just called Cthulhu erotica. It's all one title. They're on Twitter, too. I think their second book is coming out. And it's just an anthology of short stories that's erotica and romance based on H.P. Lovecraft characters. And some of it is kind of like tentacle sex, and then some of it's actual romance. So,
can it be both?
It can. It can.
Can we?
Yeah, I'm in. I'm sold.
Can we move on to JF, please? I'm starting to get rooted out by this.
You know what? No, let's keep talking about this because the way you sit, you're sitting uncomfortably in your chair amuses me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm not a prude. I can guarantee you I'm not a prude.
You should have known me as a guest I was going to ruin your show. So you should know. It's your own fault.
You didn't ruin anything, Bonnie. You didn't ruin anything.
Your own fault.
So... What I would like to see come back, saving Dave from whatever.
Robotic porn. Robotic romance.
Yes.
Now that you're speaking about it. No, actually, I'd love to see a return of some pulp. Some pulp sci-fi. Ah. But not, you know, self-aware humor pulp sci-fi, but, you know, the real thing.
You mean like Rocketeer?
Like, Rocketeer is an excellent, amazing example. I'm just going to say Flash Gordon, but Flash Gordon would, if they were to remake that today, they would make it very self-aware. But basically have it modernized. What would pulp be today? I want to see that. I want to see, like, two-fisted action sci-fi. We don't see that anymore. And although it's, like, a style that's completely different from what I like to create, I want to enjoy the diametrical opposite, something that doesn't delve into the science too much and doesn't care about a good story, something fun.
I think we got that almost with Sky Captain.
Yeah, I was going to mention Sky Captain and the Something
Sky
of Tomorrow.
Was
right?
So horribly.
We
received.
Also flirted with it very closely with Guardians of the Galaxy. Guardians of the Galaxy is
I would
flirts
say
with
that. I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy, I think, is going to open the doors for a lot of different sci-fi, humor sci-fi, but also just crazy stuff. I mean, having Groot and Rocket be major characters is great, because then that kind of opens the door for major characters to just be that crazy. There's something in Star Wars called the Rogue Squadron. Wraith Squadron. Which is very much like Guardians of the Galaxy, because you have a Gamorrean guard who's a rebel pilot. You have a rebel pilot that's a human body but a horse head. I can't remember his name. And then Jackson, the Green Rabbit, the Green Mercenary Rabbit. I mean, that is such a
rocket. Is there going to be a Hoojib?
Yeah, that's a rocket type character if I've ever seen one. So I would be excited to see more Guardians of the Galaxy type stuff, like that pulp and just weird characters in different franchises. So I'm hoping
just some of the messed up, you know, set pieces that you see, like, oh, it's a planet, but it's also a head of a thing. We're not going to bother explaining that. Nerds can probably dig up the actual origin of it from somewhere, but just having these weird things all over, and not necessarily, what's fun about Guardians of the Galaxy is that they put these things in, felt no responsibility to explain these weird things, and the public just accepted it because, it's weird. Who cares? Give me more of this strange story, and that's what I want to see come back.
Yeah.
I love humor and all, but especially if you remove the self-aware humor from it, like, you don't need to win with a dance number every time, but if we can see more of these stories, I'd be thrilled.
I think also maybe Doctor Who has kind of opened that up too, because you have sci-fi humor, but you also have just weird characters that don't need to be spoon-fed to us. And I think the resurgence of Doctor Who has helped kind of like prime the next generation of moviegoers and TV watchers to be like that, to be okay with that and not have to have everything explained, to not have everything be realistic or gritty. Like, it could have a sense of humor and it could be bizarre, and I think that's helping.
It's basically to have the palate cleanser between the Gravities and the Interstellar, which are amazing movies, and I love them, but they're very serious, very hardcore, to have that kind of, like, something to wash out the serious taste.
Yeah, we need more Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy type stuff and Red Dwarf. Like, I feel like even Spaceballs...
They're making more series of Red Dwarf. Do you know how excited I am about that? No, you don't, because you don't know me, but I am very excited about that.
I will tell you, I'm a huge Red Dwarf fan, and I would love that, because Red Dwarf was, like, kind of... It felt like a Hitchhiker.
Oh, it's happening. They're making two new series.
Yeah, and to me, it's like, I need that humor. I mean, and Mel Brooks said he's going to do another Spaceballs. He's doing a sequel to Spaceballs, so I'm excited for that as well. So
pretty good time for that, right? I mean, because Star Wars is coming back, so why not Spaceballs?
Yeah, he said he's going to do it after Star Wars, so I'm hoping that he, like, makes fun of it like he did with, you know, Spaceballs. But that was, I don't know, I want more humor in my sci-fi as well, and I'm hoping that with Guardians of the Galaxy and Doctor Who and more shows like that, that will help. And there's a lot of web series out there that are doing, like, Space Janitors is a great example of that, and that's a web series on Geek & Sundry.
that Killjoy show doesn't really explain the science too much. They just go out and get their guy and come back and, you know, do their job. They don't really, like, they haven't yet shown how they get from their main ship down to the planet. Like,
right.
They've hardly shown any of how the technical stuff works. You just know that they're in space or they're on the planet and they're fighting people with ray guns. It's really kind of a fun show.
What I'm kind of looking for is a step forward where they show something, but it's bizarre and they don't explain why it's bizarre. That's the level of sci-fi that I want to see. That's what was great about Guardians of the Galaxy and some of these other more pop fish type of things. That's kind of one I think is missing a bit right now.
There's another show called Hyperdrive with Nick Frost. That's from 2006. I think that's on Netflix still. And that's a comedy show that's very Red Dwarf-esque. And it's British humor, which of course is going to be amazing. But it's a really good series, and that's a space comedy as well. So you should check that out if you haven't. It's called Hyperdrive with Nick Frost. So I'm just putting that out there because I love Nick Frost stuff, and I love any comedy where either he or... Like, I would love to see Edgar Wright and basically Simon Pegg and Nick Frost and anybody else do a sort of a space sci-fi show that's funny. But I know that we got our trilogy, and we have to be okay with it. I mean, we got, you know, the last movie did have that sci-fi element to it. World's End is probably one of my favorite comedy sci-fi attack movies now, because it's a pub crawl with alien invasion, robot invasion. It's so great. Yeah. But I'm with you. I want more comedy. I don't want it just to be gritty and dystopian and apocalyptic. I want there to be humor. I want there to be... I love Mad Max Fury. I love, like, all this gritty stuff that we're getting, but I need humor or else we're all going to commit suicide at some point. So we need to have some sort of, like, humor in our sci-fi. I don't want it to be always serious or always dark. Even though my lights are getting dimmer and it looks like I'm...
You're getting dark and gritty. But what I'm saying, like, I agree with you. Like, some humor is cool. What I'm looking at is kind of like that weird middle ground where it's not dark and gritty but not humorous like a comedy like Galaxy Quest either. But, you know, how do I say?
No, I get it. You don't want it to be too ha-ha, but you want it to at least have an element of humor of it so it's not dark all the time.
Exactly. And be more, have that kind of Indiana Jones punching Nazis type of thing.
Yeah, we don't.
If Iron Skies wasn't so self-aware, maybe that would have been cool.
Yeah. No, all I mean, right. What was the Hitler Comes Back? Was that Dead Snow?
Danger 5?
No,
Dead Snow is a zombie movie with Nazis.
Oh, right, okay. Danger 5 is a good
Danger
example.
Danger 5, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, no. The Iron Sky. Iron Sky is a perfect example of that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but again, it was a bit too self-aware and kitschy, but it gets it. Like, you get the proper feel for it.
Yeah.
I think we all understand what I'm saying, even though I'm explaining it like a moron.
Hey, I think
I just enjoyed the movie.
Right now would be a great time. Now would be a great time for a drink. So let's have one, shall we?
Can I foreshadow the drink by saying that I want to drink both of these so that I can bring the balance back to my stomach? Bring the balance back to my stomach.
I got it. Stomach.
I wrote that like okay, 2 days ago.
Let me explain here.
Oh my god, we're going through an extra vortex. What's going on?
Okay. Perfect. All right. So the geek trick of the week is Jedi Sith. Since we were talking.
Did someone
say
just
again?
Dave?
Did we just
Did you
lose?
Guys hear me?
Oh no! Was somebody?
We were losing you.
Hello.
Yeah, we're starting to lose you, Dave.
Yeah, you went through some weird time warp.
Yeah, I know. I'm back. Am I back?
Yes, you're back now.
Okay, I'm
hey,
sorry.
Let's talk about drinks.
Okay, I'm sorry. all right, so the geek drinks of the week is the Jedi and the Sith, and I'll do the Jedi first. The Jedi ingredients are 1 ounce pineapple rum, 1 ounce coconut rum, a 0.5 ounce blue how do you pronounce that?
Caraco.
Okay, that and Sprite. The Sith ingredients are, I hope you guys are taking notes on this, 1 ounce black cherry rum, 1 ounce cherry pucker, 0.5 ounce grenadine, and 0.5 ounce vanilla rum. Top it off with Sprite. And here are your directions. Pour alcohol in a cocktail shaker with ice. Shake vigorously. Strain into an old-fashioned glass. Fill with Sprite. Add ice. Choose your side of the force. So which drink are you guys going to partake in? Which are you Sith or are you Jedi?
I'm philosophically Jedi, but I think taste-wise I'd go for Sith.
Yeah, Sith sounds better to me than the Jedi.
I'm going to the dark side, dude. Sorry.
Yeah, dark side for me too. All
right, so we're about even. I'll try both.
Well, I did say originally that's what I would do, just to bring balance to the Force, but...
No, I almost forgot that. All right.
Why is it the logo pulsating and not your face? Are you drinking secretly? I'll just see the logo. I don't see you anymore. Did you just disappear to go drink underneath your desk?
Yes, no, I was having low bandwidth issues, so I had to turn off my camera. So
that's what you did on the show, is when you started drinking heavily, you just went to the logo.
I should do that and play some like crazy, like weird music when we're doing the Geek Drink of the Week.
Yeah, that's all right.
Some techno or some light cocktail music.
There you go.
Something from Prohibition era.
Yeah, you know, there we go.
There is a Miko Star Wars disco album that you could play disco versions of the Cantina song and disco versions of the Imperial March, so there's always that.
Or the Andrew Allen jazz versions of the Star Wars music.
Oh, that might be lounge. The Cocktail Lounge Star Wars CD is amazing. So.
All right, hey, before we get out of here, I'm going to play a phone call from Jason from Kansas, long-time listener of Sci-Fi Geeks Club and follower of Galactic Netcast. So here is Jason. Here you go.
Hey, everybody. Jason from Kansas. I just wanted to call and say, hey, it's been a while. My wife and I were over today, Saturday, in Hutchinson, Kansas. They renamed it Smallville for the day because they have a little Smallville con there. And just to let you guys know that we had a blast and got to meet Vernon Wells. He played one of the bad guys in the second Mad Max film, the guy with the mohawk. He comes up over the hood of the truck, and, you know, it was cool to meet him. He was also in Commando. He's been in hundreds of movies, I guess. Anyways, got to meet him and Katrina Wall from Green Arrow. Yeah, from Arrow. I think it's Ra's al Ghul's daughter. Got to meet her. She's a total sweetheart. Billy D. Williams was there. His line was a mile long, and his prices were a mile high, so we didn't get to see him. But still cool to be less than 10 feet from it. Anyways, a lot of cool people there. Had a blast. Just thought I'd let you all know. Take it easy. Talk to you all later.
All right. Bye. Thank you, Jason. And if you want to leave us feedback, you can call our voicemail number, 805-328-3966, 805-328-3966. Also, another option is to go to our website, gncasts.com, and click on the right-hand side, leave us a voicemail there, or email galacticnetcasts@gmail.com, galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. A couple other things. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcasts, and we have a one all-in-one handy-dandy subscription page on our website, gncast.com. Just click on subscribe, and you'll get all the proper links and all the right information on there as well. And what else? You can follow us on Twitter, Facebook, Google+. Join our Facebook group and be part of the family with Galactic Netcasts. And I want to thank Bonnie Burton for being our guest geek this week. Bonnie?
Thank you. I'm sorry it's like getting darker in my apartment. I forgot to turn on an extra light, so it looks like I'm slowly dying. But thank you for having me on, and I apologize for being verbose and talking too much.
No, but, you do not have to apologize for that. That's,
nope.
That's why we brought you on.
But, always makes for a good show.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. It's always fun to talk with fellow geeks and nerds about the things we love. So I appreciate you caring about my opinion. So thank you.
Absolutely. You're welcome. Where can people find you? Where do you want to direct people online to your stuff?
Oh, well, you can just, if you're on Twitter, my Twitter handle is Bonnie Girl. It's just Bonnie, B-O-N-N-I-E-G-R-R-L. And I'm on there all the time, so I post my articles that I've written for CNET and SFX and Playboy and Disney on there. But I also, I mentioned earlier, I do a romance book club show with Felicia Day, Veronica Belmont, and Kyla Casby called Vaginal Fantasy Romance Book Club. And you can just go to vaginalfantasy.com. It's not porn. It's a Tumblr of all of our previous episodes. Or you could just go to youtube.com/vaginalfantasy, and you can see our latest episodes there as well. And next Tuesday, we're going to have a Google Hangout like this. But instead of drinking dirt, I'll be drinking scotch, and we'll be talking about dinosaur erotica.
Wait, what kind of scotch?
Well, it's bourbon. So I drink bullet bourbon, or I'll drink anything scotch that I know someone in a kilt made.
That can be a lot of things.
If there's like plaid on the packaging, I'll probably drink it. but I'm definitely a bourbon girl as well. So Maker's Mark and
the whiskeys in general.
Well, yeah, all of it. All the dad drinks, as I called it. The amber dad drinks. You know, the kind of drinks where, like, you're not allowed to talk to your dad unless he's had two of them, and then you could talk to him, like, when you were a little kid. Is that just my family? Maybe that's just my family.
Sounds like it's
scotch rule, that we were allowed to bother our dad until he's had two scotches, and then he could handle kids asking for raises and wanting Ataris and things like that. So, but yeah, that's how people can reach me. I'm online, too. If you just do a search on my name, you'll find my Facebook and Google Hangout, Amazon page, and all that. But Twitter's usually where I dwell the most.
All right. Thank you, Bonnie. Thank you, JF, Anessa, and Brett.
Can I plug my book real quick? Since you are on Alpha Geek, when there's like a new audience, I want to like take advantage, like marketing.
Yeah. Before you do, though, I do want to mention that thanks everybody for tuning in on Alpha Geek Radio. And we'll be back next week live at 9:45 p.m. Eastern time. And we're also working on getting our other shows on Alpha Geek Radio as well. And Alpha Geek has their stuff on a ton of different platforms. Like almost any place where you can listen or watch things on, you can get the Alpha Geek Radio shows. Like they've got the TuneIn Radio app. They've got the website. They've got they're on Xbox, PlayStation. They're on Roku now. It's Apple TV. It's crazy. Just go to tunein.alphageekradio.com and you'll get all the details on that. Okay, JF, sorry. Book, go.
JF?
Hello?
Oh, no, it's frozen in some weird time vortex. He's not moving.
It's a great profile shot, though, right?
Yes, I thought he was being serious, like he was going to do a good
He was building up the energy, and then he was just going to unleash an onslaught of the awesome talking about his...
I feel like this is like a scene from Unfriended, where he's going to be like, the next clip is him being murdered by someone behind him with like... You guys didn't see that, did you? Unfriended? It's a horror film all done in Google Chat.
Yeah.
It's pretty awesome.
Well, since JF isn't here, I know you can go to jfdubeau.com. That is jfdubeau.com. And that's got a lot of his stuff.
Pick up his book, The Life Engineered.
Life Engineered.
Yep. Yeah. Actually, he's pulling down the links on Amazon because he's going to be working on the polished version because he and another person won the Sword and Laser Inkshares collection contest, and so he gets an opportunity to speak with an author, and I cannot remember the author's name at this time, but he's going to give him some advice on how to polish up the book, and then he's going to release it on Inkshares, and it's going to be a part of the Sword and Laser collection.
Yeah, speaking of Veronica Belmont.
Yeah, that Sword and Laser is her show with Tom Merritt, great. Yep. Podcast show that when she's not talking about erotica and vaginal fantasy with me and Sword and Laser talking about really cool sci-fi and fantasy with Tom Merritt. And yeah, that anthology, I'm looking forward to reading it because it looks like it's going to be amazing. But I think Sword and Laser is also on boingboing.com. Or .net. Is it .net or .com? Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
They're on that as well. So, yeah.
All right. I'm gonna call it. Okay. We gave JF enough time to get back on, but unfortunately, looks like he's not gonna make it back on. But anyways, I'm Dave Nelson, and on behalf of Brad, Anessa, Matt, and Bonnie, we will talk to you guys next time.
Bye, Dad.
Bye.
All right, hang on.